Welcome, welcome. Good morning. Hallelujah. Welcome to El Shaddai Prayer Tower. Jesus. Good morning. Good morning. Happy Monday to all. Yes. Welcome to breakfast with Jesus. May the Lord bless you here today. Yeah. Hallelujah. Good morning. Welcome. May the Lord bless you as you go ahead and begin to share this message. Hallelujah. New Jersey, good morning. Texas, welcome. Welcome. London, welcome. Good afternoon. Hallelujah. Kent, good afternoon. South Carolina, good morning. Jesus. Portland, Jamaica, good morning. As you join, I invite you to share. Waterbury, Connecticut is in the house. Hallelujah. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to Breakfast with Jesus. It's day 5 of our fasting. And we are fasting for the establishment of El Shaddai Prayer Tower. We are fasting over those covenant seeds. Please, I encourage you to join us with this covenant. Amen. It's a covenant that you are entering into for whatever is happening in your life. It's not like you're looking for prayers. No, you are holding God to his word with your covenant seed. Canada is in the house. Hartford, Connecticut is in the house. God bless you, the beautiful Nikki. Welcome. Canada again, Sister Cadian. Trinidad is in the house. Good morning, Trinidad and Tobago. Hallelujah. Welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. to God be the glory. I invite you to share. It's our fasting, and it's day 5. And I'm here to let you know, the Lord told me that the people that have joined covenant, even the ones from other ministries that have joined covenant with us to pray for the next 6 months, their doors will be open. God started opening doors since yesterday. So if you are one of the covenant partner, or if you have joined in this covenant prayers, look out for your blessings. That's all I can tell you. That's all I can say. It started yesterday. The covenant. Oh, I miss a call. Welcome to breakfast. The Lord said that those people that came into covenant, and especially the ones who are not a part of this ministry, is going to open your door. Hallelujah. Jesus. My God. We thank God for technology. We thank God for the Holy Spirit. We thank God for social media, where many can be reached far and near and come in agreement. Mighty God, Jesus, doors are about to open. Doors are opening. It was so clear in my head. It was so clear in my head, Jesus. When the Lord began to minister to me, I felt it in my spirit. But then the Lord said, I am opening doors, Jesus. Doors because of your covenant. Let me share something with you. God is very funny. God is very funny. He wants a group of people to join in prayer. So he allowed this thing to take place. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, it started yesterday. So for the month of September, we will be praying covenant prayer overseas. It's a seed of $50. Every month, a seed of $50 for the next 6 months. And we are holding it to God with our prayer requests. It's not too late. Send your seed. We're not able to be with us over the weekend because of their busy life. But at this moment, I encourage you to join us in prayer. I'm excited. I don't know, but I'm excited. I am so, so excited. And I'm thankful to God for this opportunity to pray with other people from different ministries to come together. It's a beautiful thing. When God had told the disciples that they should meet up in Jerusalem, it was not just his disciples that were there. People were there from who spoke other languages. And on that day, it was an epiphany. It was epic. Big things happened. People that didn't follow Jesus Christ got filled with the Holy Spirit. His brothers, they didn't follow him when he was doing ministry. But they showed up at Jerusalem. They wanted some of the benefits. I'm here to let you know, great benefits are coming in this covenant. So I encourage you to be a part of it. Amen. You're not late. It's for 6 straight months. Let us pray. Jesus. Let us pray. Let us talk to Jesus. You know what's on your heart. You know your challenges. You know what you're going through. You know your own story. No one knows your pastor. No one knows your story better than you. In this morning, I encourage you to open your mouth and begin to talk to God. Say something sweet to the Holy Spirit. He's already here. My God. Yes, and I feel calm after church. You're supposed to. The presence of God is here. Say something sweet to Jesus right now. I encourage you to say something sweet to the Holy Spirit. He's here. Say something wonderful. Many of you, when you meet people for the first time and you like them, and when you see them the second time, you begin to just say some nice things and make them feel good. Let us acknowledge the Holy Spirit right now. Sweet Rose of Sharon, blessed be your name. You are magnificent. You are awesome. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being among us. Thank you, Jesus, for allowing the Holy Spirit to dwell among us. Sweet Holy Ghost, we welcome you, Jesus. Sweet Holy Spirit, we welcome you in our midst. Sweet Holy Spirit, we welcome you now. Father, we thank you for yet another day. Walking in the land of the living. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to get out of bed. Many people are not privileged enough to get out of their bed. Someone has to help them out of bed. Someone has to clean them up, feed them. We are walking on top of our grave. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day that you have given us. This is the day you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. You don't owe us anything. Upon all the sin that we have committed, the lies that we have told, the backstabbing that we are into, the hypocrisy, and you still keep us alive. Lord, we are grateful. We thank you. Many of us are cheaters, and Lord God, we thank you that you're keeping us alive so we can repent. Therefore, we ask you for forgiveness. We ask you to forgive us, Lord. We ask you, Lord God, to forgive us of our sins, of our wrongdoing. Lord, we thank you for the gift of salvation. Lord, we thank you that we are able to repent and you look past our flaws and accept us. My God, the word said a saint is just a sinner who fall down and get right back up. Lord, you don't judge us. It doesn't matter what we do, you never judge us. And Lord, we thank you for always being there. You are our Savior. You fight for us. You are our mighty warrior. You are our Redeemer. You take us back. Lord, we thank you. As we place El Shaddai Prayer Tower before you, Lord, and we ask you for divine establishment. This you have given unto us. And Lord God, we are asking you for establishment of the ministry to be established all over the world. Not just in one place. Not just in two places. Not what man said, Lord, but what you said. And therefore, we are standing on your promises. You said, Peter, upon the rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And Lord, this morning we pray that anything that will prevail against El Shaddai, it will fall, whether male or female. Anything that will prevail against El Shaddai, prayer tower will go flat, will lose their strength. In the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence. We welcome you, sweet Holy Spirit. We welcome you. And as your people are sending their seeds to enter into covenant, oh God, I ask you to bless it individually. Bless them according to their prayer requests. Bless them according to their situation. Open doors, Lord God. Open windows, Lord God, and pour out in your bosom. As they send their seed, Lord God, to enter covenant with you, we ask you in the name of Jesus, let it be well with them. Strengthen them that they can afford to pray daily over their seed. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your mercies. Lord, bless our covenant partners. Bless the members of El Shaddai. Bless their home, Lord God. Bless their marriages. Bless them with spouses, the ones that are single. Give them peace. Bless the children that are connected to this ministry. Open their doors. Divine protection over them. Blood coverage over them. Have your way, O God. Let it be well with them in the name of Jesus Christ. I ask you today, Lord God, for a revival in our spirit. A revival in our spirit as we apply to the blood of Jesus Christ. Let there be a revival in our spirit in the name of Jesus Christ. Even now, I cover myself in the blood. It is day number 5 of the fasting. And I pray for divine strength to continue. Let there be a revival in our spirit. Let there be a revival in our soul. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray with thanksgiving. Heal the broken heart today. We call forth sinners to come to repentance. We call in forth backsliders. We call in forth the gunman to come, to drop that gun and come. We're calling forth the thief to stop stealing and come to Jesus. My God, we are calling for those who are in homosexual lifestyle and relationship to drop that habit and come. Lord, we are calling those same-sex lovers to quit that habit and come. We are calling forth people to come into the other direction and turn away from sin. Walk out of sin. Walk out of shame and disgrace and come. Let there be a revival in your spirit. We pray that conviction will come so they can drop bad habits and come. You said we should call them forth from the highways and the byways to come to fill up the kingdom of God according to the word of God. We should call them. We should go and root them out of the highways and the byways to fill up your kingdom. And you will do the rest. Oh Lord, we pray today for conviction. So people can walk right. So people can stop being greedy for the love of money. For the love of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the lust of the mind. Lord, we pray for a revival in our soul. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Somebody bless the Lord. Somebody bless God. Somebody bless God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Sweet Holy Ghost. Sweet Holy Spirit, thank you, Jesus. Somebody help me to bless the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Welcome. Welcome to Breakfast with Jesus. As you join, I invite you to share this message. Welcome. The Bible said the name of God is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are safe. Oh, hallelujah. We give God honor and praise. Let us thank Him. Hallelujah. Jesus. Whew. It is well. I don't know what you're going through, but it is well. Hallelujah. Somebody go ahead and share this message. I'm thankful to God to be here. It's not easy. It's not easy to do the work of God. It takes spiritual strength and physical strength to do God's work. Because you have to get out of that bed and get yourself in order to pray. And you're not just praying for yourself, you're praying for others. I know many of you, you got up and you have your own prayer session. You got up early and you pray for other people. You pray for your children, you pray for your spouse. And I'm here to say this, even if you don't have a spouse, pray for the person that God is sending to you. Be specific with God. You know your desire of your expectation. You know your expectation of what you want a spouse to be like in your home, walking around with you. So pray to God and be specific. You're fasting. Ask God to fix this man. And if you're not married, ask God to, if you're a man and you're here and you're not married, ask God to fix the woman that you want to marry. I'm speaking to some men. If you are here and you're not married, I don't care if you live with someone, because it's we mankind have tendency. As long as we can play around in the relationship, we don't think it's okay to get married. And many of us, we desire this big old wedding, this everlasting wedding that we cannot afford. Yet we are saying that we don't have the money. And you know you can't afford it. So you will never get married because you're hanging your basket where you can't reach it. Stop it. It's time to make a decision to settle down. A lot of people, I'm not ready to get married yet because the ring that I want. You need to bend your mind to your situation. Stay in your lane. You want to get married. Come out of sin. But you are holding God accountable for the things that you are not able to do. God is only looking for people who are available to use them. You want money to spend on the wedding that you don't have. Yet you're telling God you're not getting married till you have the money. Listen, you are living the life. You make a decision to be broke. It's true. You know, when I was younger, people used to say to me, why would you go to sleep if you know that you don't have food to give your four children in the morning? You're supposed to find a way to work it out. So when the morning comes, your children have food. God give us the ability to do it. God gave us the ability to do it, and we are making excuses. And I learned that God gave me the ability, so I'm going to make necessary preparation because God did his part. Now it's time for me to do my part. If I don't put food in my house, God bless me so I can put the food in the house. So tomorrow when it's time for me to break my fast, then there won't be nothing to eat. Knowledge is power. Knowledge is power. You want to get married. You're living the full-blown relationship with that person, and you know that you cannot afford a ring. And yet you're doing everything that married people are supposed to do. Aren't you afraid of God? You call yourself a child of God. You're in a full-blown relationship and you're not married. I'm speaking to unmarried people. You're not married. And you're living the life that the... May the Lord help you. May the Lord help you. You said you're waiting on the Lord, but yet you are still fooling around. You are waiting on the Lord. You're asking God to send you, especially some women. You're asking God to send you a husband, but yet you're talking to multiple men. May the Lord help you. You're doing everything that married people do, yet you're single. It's time to wake up. You won't have anything to offer when you're getting married because you wear out everything. You won't have anything to offer because you wear out everything. You see, when you didn't have anyone to tell you, it is different. But now you have somebody who will tell you the truth so you can pull up your socks and come out of sin. Anything that you are doing, like what married people are supposed to do, and you're not married, it's a sin. Nobody's perfect. Nobody's telling you to leave your spouse. But do what you have to do and stop talking about you don't have money to pay for anything. You're already living the life. A lot of people are married and they married without the ring because they can't afford it. When God bless you with that money, or when you decide to stop spending so heavy, you can buy a ring. Listen, we're not talking about the past. We're talking about the future. What we did in the past is of the past. We cannot bring the past into the future. It won't work. Many reasons why people are hanging around, holding on to some dead relationship, carrying that dead weight, is because they are still in the past. God already moved and shift you, and you're still calling those people. What's wrong with you? It means that you didn't let go. So how are you going to receive a spouse if you're still attached? Your soul is tied to somebody. Release yourself. That person didn't do anything to you. So it's time to delete that phone number and wait on the Lord. Or go pray. Go pray. Go on fasting. And you cannot be on fasting and still indulge in certain conversation that will block your blessing. Condescending to sin. I don't know why God is using me to say this morning, but I speak with no apologies. People like to be encouraged in sin. I'm not doing it. You cannot say that you're waiting for God to send you a spouse and you're still in hotel bedroom. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, help us. Help us. Why me, Lord? Why me, Lord? Why me, Lord? You are claiming that you are single, yet you're in relationships, multiple relationships. You tie your soul with other people. You are sending nude pictures to other people. And you call yourself a child of God. You know what that says about you? You're not clean. You're not ready for what you're asking God for. And this is why God will prepare people to minister to you who will not compromise the word of God. You cannot say that you're waiting for a spouse and you're still doing it 90 going north. Oh! Wait. Wait on the Lord. Did you know, I said this before, did you know that even when you get married, there are times that you're going to have to look at your spouse and cannot touch them because you're fasting, you're under subjection. You see, when you submit to God, you will be disciplined. You will be disciplined. Say that a little louder, Sister Angela. He that know the truth and don't do it is a sin. So if you didn't know, now you know. You cannot say you didn't know. God prepares somebody with a big mouth to bring it forth to you. You're asking God to bless you, and you're still chasing skirts. You're a man. I'm speaking to some men. A lot of men are following me and they don't say nothing. They stay there in the back and they take notes and they watch and then they send me messages when we're done. A lot of you men who think that it's okay to chase down these women and test them out like a bicycle or a new car. You're trying to ride to break off the brakes and then you switch to another female. Let me tell you, God is not pleased. God is not pleased. Men are supposed to live a life for women to respect them. Men are not supposed to be weak. And when men keep chasing skirts, it's out of weakness. A woman don't want a weak man. Let me tell you something. If you get involved with a cheater, that person's going to cheat on you. If you get involved with a cheater, they are going to cheat on you. At some point. And you know the liar and the cheater, they wear the same size shoes because you have to lie to cover your track. If you are messing around with someone who is already involved, and you're saying, but he's not married. You know what? He's going to play that same game with you. The same way a woman is supposed to be able to put her flesh under subjection is the same way a man is supposed. I was watching a young man. I think he's in his 20s. I think he's a businessman. Very famous. And he said he broke up with someone that was not his. You know, young people, they talk different because I'm old school. He said he broke up with the girl and it took him 6 months. He started writing. He stayed celibate. And we know what the word celibate mean. Celibate mean you abstain from other relationship sexually. You're not involved with anyone. You're chill. So he said he stayed celibate and he began to write and God began to speak to him. So for 6 months, he stayed clean because whatever he was into didn't work out. And if a young man in his 20s can place that flesh, remember they are hot-blooded. And he can place that flesh under subjection and come back to testify that it took 6 months for him to be successful because he was not in any relationship. He messed up and he withdraw himself and he bounced back stronger. The same way a woman can do it. I'm talking to some old tough congruent women with gray hair. Some of enter in their 30s and they start having gray hair. I got gray hair when I was 29. I saw gray hair right here at the side of my head. Too strong. And until today, they are still there. No matter how I pluck them out, they come back. I started graying in my 20s. So I'm talking to some people who think they cannot do without going to bed or strip naked in front of the phone and allow people to look. You don't have to do that. You don't have to be a clone. Jesus. You don't have to be a clone. God wants to make an example out of you. You don't have to make a spectacle out of yourself to be approved. I'm not trying to be funny. My spirit is angry because the thing is happening as we speak. It's Monday morning. Somebody just came out of a hotel bed. It's time to be clean. Let me tell you something. Some men will allow women to feel like they are not qualified or they don't meet they don't fit the part. You are all that and more. When the right man comes, the things that he will do for you, it will make you regret the foolishness you are doing. It doesn't matter your age. Stop telling people that you're getting old. Wait. You see, when you put yourself out there like that, sometimes the right people see you and they pass you by because you're not in any position to wait. Lord Jesus, who am I talking to? Put your flesh under subjection. God don't lie. The book of Numbers, it tells us. I'm going to go into it. Let us read the book of Numbers. Somebody need to hear this today. God will never lie to you. God will never deceive you. God will never ever trick you. Whatever God said, it's true. Turn your Bible to the book of Numbers. Hallelujah. Go to verse 19. No, the book of Numbers chapter 23, go to verse 19. I want to read this with every one of us here today. I want you to know, I want to back up my argument with a scripture. That's how confident God is. I want to back up all that I just said with the word of God. You will be like a virgin when the right person come. And they will love you and love you and love you and all over you. And they will appreciate every wrinkle, every stretch mark, every scar on your body. Numbers chapter 23, verse 19. I want you to read it. God bless you, woman of God. It says, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the Son of Man, that he should repent. Hath he said it and shall not do it? Or hath he spoken and shall not make it good? Let us read verse 20. Many of you need to know that God is serious about you. That's why you are on this fasting with us. That's why you came into covenant. It's not to trick you, it's to open your eyes. Let's read verse 20. It said, behold, I have received commandment to bless, and ye have blessed, and I cannot reverse it. So your blessings cannot be reversed. Whatever God says he's going to do, he will do it. These scriptures dwell among me. I feed on these scriptures. These are promises from God. When God said he's going to bless you, God is not making any jokes that he's going to bless you. We all want God blessing, but we have to be prepared. We have to be ready. We have to be clean. If you find that you keep talking about other people, you're not prepared for any blessing. If you find that your mouth, you can't be quiet. You can't control your mouth. You cannot put a bridle over your mouth. You're not ready for any blessing. There are some things that are about to happen, then you're going to have to be quiet. If you find that you can't keep telling people what's happening to you, every move you make, you text and you tell them, listen to me, you're not ready for your blessings. Because there will come a time that even you're not even your very children, you cannot share information with that God gave you. There will come a time when not even your very children that you birthed out or that came from your loins, you can't give them the information that God revealed to you. You have to be quiet. So if you find that you don't believe in the promises of God, and you are out there trying to make it happen, you're doing it wrong. You are doing it wrong. And if God give you a wife, I'm talking to some men, if God give you a wife, stop messing with other women. You're wasting their time. You're messing with their mental state. If you are here and you are a man, and you already God show you your wife, he showed you a woman and said, that woman is going to be your wife. It's time for you to drop the excess lyrics that you saved up to give to other women and give it to this particular woman. Because there, even if the woman don't have money and you love money, there is something about that woman why God wants her to be your spouse, your helpmate. The Bible call it helpmate. God give Adam a helpmate. And when God is mandating helpmates, men need to relax as well. Stop going around fooling other women when God already showed you your wife. No, I'm talking to some women. You are mandated to be a helpmate for a man, not for somebody else's husband. Jesus. You have been mandated. You have been mandated to be a helpmate for your husband, not for somebody else's husband. Many of us, we do it out of our flesh because we like the man and we make sure no other woman don't get him. Did God tell you that man is your husband? Or you like him? The other day, the Lord told me to ask a woman who is married, did God tell you that man is your husband? And the woman said she had a dream that she and the man was doing things together. But God didn't tell her that the man is her husband. That's the problem. I pray that you will find peace. For those of you that are here and are married, I pray that you will find peace. Peace with God. Favor with your spouse. And I pray that your spouse will find favor with you. Many times you see some older women and older men, whether they are saved or not, they don't have wisdom. They don't have wisdom. The things that they say, whether they are in public or private, the things that they do. So you cannot take advice. Some older people are baptized, but they are not saved. So you cannot tell them your business. You cannot take advice from them. It makes you foolish. Why? If you are not getting your blessings and you are a child of God, it means that you are doing things foolishly. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the ungodly counsel of men. So when you are messing around with people who are not godly, it makes you foolish. They turn you into complete idiots. I'm saying it because it's true. You see, many of us, the Bible makes it clear for us, but we don't pay attention. We like people because they're good looking and they are intelligent. Okay, it's okay to be intelligent. But make sure the people that you're taking advice from, they are saved. Make sure your best friend that you're telling your business is saved, is godly, is a godly person. And being baptized don't make anybody godly. It's the life that you live, the things of the heart. Open your Bible to the book of Psalm. I'm just going to keep it basic today. Some people need to know the truth. Some people need to know why they are not being blessed and being in Christ for so many years and you're not being blessed. There are some things you need to stop doing. And there are some new things you need to start doing. Turn your Bible with me to the book of Psalms chapter 1. Somebody put up Psalms chapter 1 verse 1. The first verse in the book of Psalms, chapter 1. It's easy to find. Psalms come right after Job. So I encourage you to post the scripture so we can all read it together. My God. Blessed is the man that walketh not in counsel of ungodly men. What does that tell us? When people are, you see, I pray that this message drop in the right spot in somebody's spirit here today. Blessed is the man that walketh not. Mean do not walk in the counsel of ungodly people. You lose your blessing. It turns you into an idiot. You cannot be working so hard, praying so hard, fasting so hard, and now you realize that you've been doing it wrong the whole time because it's not your prayers that block your blessing. It's not the fasting. It is the friend. It is the people that you are telling your business. They rob you your blessing. So all this time you're waiting for God to bless you and no doors are opening. Why? Because you are giving out information about your life to the wrong people. That's why you're not being blessed yet. Telling everybody you are Christian, praying for everybody, spitting scripture, going off in the spirit, this and that and the whole works, speaking in tongues. And nothing is happening. Why? Because you're telling people your business. You're taking advice from ungodly people. That alone is a blocker. It blocks your blessing. It's the way that you're doing it. This is a tool today. I'm giving you the tool that you need. My God. Jesus. Mighty God, you need this tool. You have been fasting. You have been praying. You have been doing everything right and no results. Why? Check the people that you're taking advice from. Who are giving you advice. Who are telling you how to do things. Check them out. Do not sit down and take advice from ungodly people. It will block your blessings. Many of your friends don't even know how to pray. And they are your bestie. Your bestie can't pray. Your bestie cannot pray for you. Your bestie is not even saved. But your bestie know everything about you. How are you going to be blessed? You know that bad associations spoil good habits. That is the word of God. This is when bad association is spoiling your prayer life. Is making you doubt God. Look how long you are praying and fasting. No results. Because you have a friend that is blocking your blessing. That cousin, that auntie that you're telling everything. You need to stop. They are ungodly. That uncle, that sister, that brother that is living life unrighteously. They can't make. You see, they will block your blessings. You're doing everything right. You fast, you pray, you worship God, you're generous to God's people, you're living clean, but there is a big old problem. That auntie that you trust because she claims that she's a Christian and she is the devil from hell. She's not godly. She is binding you up. That best friend, that cousin, that church brethren that you trust because they speak in tongues, who is still practicing witchcraft. That's why you're not being blessed, because the person that you are holding on to for dear life still going to Obiaman, still going to psychic. That's why you don't get your blessing yet. That's why you don't receive that house yet. That's why you cannot start that business yet, because the devil is right there binding you up. And you know what? You begin to doubt God. You begin to limit God. You begin to only pray in one part of your house, because you only find out that when you stay at this part, you feel the presence of the Holy Spirit. Your house is not the problem. It's your mouth. If the Bible tells you that you will be blessed when you don't take advice from ungodly people, what does that make you see? Look out of your physical eye. You don't even need the Holy Spirit for this one. You don't need the Holy Spirit. Many of us, our bestie is not even a Christian. They don't know nothing about God. When I use the word bestie, I'm relating to the person that you share everything with. They know everything about you. They don't know God. How will you get your spouse when your bestie don't know nothing about and somebody open them out and pray. Oh Lord, help me. Help me. Send the right people to me, oh God, that I can receive my blessings. Send me the right people, Daddy Jesus. Ask God to send you the right people. Now you see why. Sometimes you have to drop some of those baggages in order to be blessed. And they will tell you, what happened? I've not heard from you in a couple of months. You met somebody? Yes. No, because you stopped sharing your business with that person. God opened your door. Because you were blocking your own blessing. Somebody said, if you don't like what's happening around you or happening in your circle, be the instrument of change. Be that instrument of change. If you don't like what's happening in your family, be that instrument of change. Our assignment, it requires connection. So we all need that connection. We all need that destiny helper. But if your destiny helper, my God, if your destiny helper, what is, if you are claiming that this person is your destiny helper and God didn't say it, you're going to have a problem. Let us ask God to send us the right people. It's not everything your pastor need to know. Why? God already showed that to your pastor. So when you are saying, pastor already knows, so pastor is going to be quiet and listen if there's anything new. Pastor won't say anything to you because God didn't give pastor any message to tell you. That does not mean that pastor don't know. Our assignment need connection so it can be fulfilled. But we need the right connection. Not people that we choose because we like their skin color, or we like the way they dress, or because they went to a certain school, or because they're part of a certain group. No. 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 You know what the Bible said? In 2 Samuel verse 1, I'm going to read. You don't have to go there, but I'm going to go there. If you want, you can go there. 2 Samuel chapter 1. 2 Samuel chapter 1 verse 26. I'm going to read something to you. It says, I just love the way God set us up to bless us. That's all I can say. The way he set us up to bless us. God is very funny. 2 Samuel chapter 1 verse 26. Hallelujah. This was David crying. Just to let you know, just so you know, just so you know, when God send your destiny helper, there was a time when Jonathan was David's destiny helper. But when his time expired, David cry. 2 Samuel chapter 1 verse 26. Read what it says. Remember, that was his brother-in-law. His future brother-in-law. It said, I am distressed for thee, my brother Jonathan. Very pleasant hast thou been unto me. Thy love to me was wonderful, passing the love of women. So you see, we all need someone to connect to fulfill the assignment. When Saul tried to kill David so many times, who saved him? Jonathan. Who was Jonathan? Saul's son. They had a connection. They didn't have a relationship like men and women. No. They were friends. David and Jonathan loved each other past the relationship like what men had with women. It passed that. So it was not a sexual thing. They had love because they were friends. They were there to help each other to the next level. Jonathan wanted to be. There was a time when Jonathan wanted to be David armor bearer. He said, David, when you become king, I want to be your armor bearer. It didn't happen. Because Jonathan died the same day his father died, Saul. So David said, how I weep for you, my brother Jonathan. They were like brothers. He was his brother-in-law. He said, how I weep for you, my brother Jonathan. How much I love you. and your love for me was deeper than the love of women. David knew what it is like to be with many, many women. So he know that the love that Jonathan had for him was deeper. Jonathan loved him. He said, I want to be your armor bearer. He was honest. He was sincere. Even though he knew that Saul, the king, wanted to kill David. He said, I know you are chosen by God. I know you are the king. I know my father is not a king. He does not have the qualities that make him to be a king. So you see, your physical lifestyle supposed to, yes, it's supposed to exude kingship. But David had the blood of kings running through his veins. He had royal blood running through his veins. Saul didn't have royal blood. He was chosen by the people, not by God. I came to talk to someone here today. If things are not going well in your life, in your house, be that instrument of change. Stop talking about it. I came today with tools. And I want you to know that today's sermon might run into 2 days. So this could be part one. Tomorrow will be part two of the same message because it's long. Amen. Your assignment need connection. David needed Jonathan. How did David meet these people? God send David to the king's house to play a musical instrument so the king could be released from that demon that he was possessed with. Saul had a demon that God placed on him so David could meet him. You see, when God is setting you up to bless you, you don't have to do anything. You don't have to send naked picture to anybody. When the right time come, God will connect you with the right people. He will cause somebody to have a sickness and you will go there to pray. He will cause somebody to have a problem and your skills will be required. David didn't have to speak to Saul. He played the harp. And the man was delivered from that spirit that made him mad. His advisors told him that he had a mad spirit. And he needed someone that was pure. Hello, somebody. He needed someone that was pure. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And David was pure. So you see, when you have certain issues, people who are unclean, they cannot join that bandwagon to pray for you, to bring your deliverance. There are some people talking about they are a part of deliverance ministry and they are not clean. So people come there and instead of they get delivered, they leave with more spirits. Oh, Holy Spirit, we thank you for this one. You will go to a deliverance ministry for deliverance and you leave with more demons that you went with. Why? Because the person that laid hand on you need deliverance. Their heart is not in the right place. They have the gift to do it, but their heart is not pure. Who am I talking to here today? The Bible said when David and Jonathan met, they clicked. They became buddies. They became best friend. David didn't go to that house to marry to anybody, to marry King Saul's daughter. He went there to play the harp so the man could be delivered from his demons. But when he found out who David was, the man was skilled. The man could fight. The man could pray. The members of Saul's household told Saul, the king, that David was also an intercessor. He was a prayer warrior. He was not only a musician. This is why when you're reading the book of Psalm, you will see musician. If you pay attention, you will see musician. Because David was a musician. If you have certain Bible and you're reading the book of Psalm, it will tell you to the chief musician from where, because David was also a musician. So you see, musicians have to be clean. Musicians have to be clean to bring forth deliverance. to people with certain spirits. This is why when you go to church and they're doing praise and worship, you can receive your deliverance during praise and worship. Who am I talking to? You can receive deliverance right there in the praise and worship. Once they are worshiping God and praising God, once those members are clean, you will be delivered. You don't, no one has to lay hands on you. You will be slain right there in your seat in the pew. You don't have to go to the podium. The Holy Spirit will visit you right there in your seat, because the musicians are clean. The musicians are pure. You know what brought me to Jesus Christ? When I heard that man under the tent talking about, look at you, whole tough corn grain. You need to give your life to God. What are you doing? What are you looking for in hell? And it hit me like a ton of bricks. I said, why is he talking about me like this? I was offended. I was convicted. And then the man began to say, in my church, I want you to listen good. These are the things that pull me closer to Christ. He said, in my church, none of my musicians cannot touch my mic unless they are anointed. I said, Jesus Christ, this is the place I need to be. This is what I need to hear. I did not know God was calling me to ministry because I was wretched. The man said, I tell God, if I ever cheat on my wife, to kill me. I said, this is the man that I need to meet. I need to hear this type of teachings. I didn't just want to fight him. What God was using him to say, it convicted me to let me know that men can be faithful to your wife. If you have an unfaithful husband, I pray that the Lord settle him, settle his spirit in this marriage. If you are living with an unfaithful husband, if any woman here living with a man that is unfaithful, it means that his spirit is not settled. I pray that his spirit will be settled in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Paul said, let every man have their own wife. Let every woman have their own husband. My God. So according to the word of God, David was crying. David said, this man loved me more than any woman would love. More than any woman loved me. David was a lover boy. He was a lover boy. He had all these women that couldn't resist him. He was irresistible. And he was saying, Jonathan, my brother, you're dead, you're gone, but I know you love me genuinely. You see, God is looking for people today who are genuine. We're tired of fake people. We're tired of the fake hallelujah. We are tired of the fake Holy Ghost. We are tired of being tired of the fake things in ministry. We need the right people around us. We need to hear the truth. We are tired of fake Christians. We are tired of fake pastors. We are tired of the fake hallelujah. We are tired of the fake everything. We need the truth. We need true worshipers to worship God with us. We're tired. Enough is enough. Enough is enough. Too much flesh in God's business, and it causes contamination. People are not getting their deliverance. Too much flesh around here. We're tired. We're tired to see them. We're tired to listen to them. We're tired of being in their presence. My God, the young man is in his 20s. He said he was in the wrong relationship. And when he left the relationship, look, I'm talking about that. He's like a baby in his 20s. He said he started to write. He turned to God. He was inspired. And it took 6 months of celibacy to set him on the right path. So you see, sometimes you have to walk away from that dirty flesh
All it causes pain. Do you know many people when they're, I remember there was a reggae music because I used to love the dance. I do, really do. And there was a reggae music that says, sitting in your church on Sunday, thinking who you're gonna sleep with on Monday, who you're gonna kill, who you're gonna rob. It don't please God. That's what the song said. So you see, many of those reggae music, they have a lesson for you to learn. Because if you really listen to the song, it says, sitting in your church on Sunday, thinking who you're gonna sleep with on Monday, who you're gonna kill, who you're gonna rob. Let me tell you, it don't please God. That's what the song said. God is not an author of confusion. We cannot mock him. We cannot mock God. Jesus. It is well. Hello? Okay. People of God, let me tell you this. We can't mock God. We can't play. How long are we going to play church? Psalms 1 verse 1 tells us that when we continue to tell people our business, when we continue to tell them the things that will make us to be blessed, they are holding us down. Today we pray that God will send the right people to us. You see, we are praying for the establishment of the church. We don't want no fake people around us. If you are partnering with us with your covenant seed, we are praying that God remove fake people from around you. If you are here today from a different ministry and you are partnering with us with the 6 months covenant, my prayer is that God remove everyone from around you that is fake. Those who are preaching to you are fake. Those who are whispering in your ear, talking about their friends and they are fake and ungodly. We are asking God to move them. None of us are not perfect, but we are tired of being around fake people. We don't want no friends from no fake people. Look what David said. After Saul tried to kill him so many times, Jonathan was right there with him to give him the message, David, it's time to move. Go into the bush and hide. My daddy is coming to kill you. He was genuine. He loved David. You cannot establish on fake. You cannot build on crooked. My God, when problem come, what you gonna do? If you met a friend and the whole time they was just flossing and spending other people's money and pretending to be rich and acting all goody-goody, and when that money finish and you became friends with them because based on what they present to you and they cannot deliver, what you gonna think? They fake. You should have prayed before you get involved with these people. Lord, I know they look good. Lord, I know they pray in tongues. Lord, I know they know the scripture, but Lord, are they real? Send me the right people, Lord. I'm tired of being around flesh, too much flesh. I'm done with the flesh. I'm done with the world and these worldly things. Somebody open them out and pray. Let us ask God to send us the right people. We are praying for the establishment. We don't need to build it on messy ground. We need it to be on solid ground. We need it to be on holy ground. We need it to fill with the fire of God. We don't need it to be filled with looking good people who are fake. That will destroy our blessings. My God. I don't know. Hey, Bariko Saya, I don't know. I smell blood. I smell a man of sin. There was a fight. The Spirit of the Lord is ministering to me. There was a fight. And I am on the scene that murder was committed. I smell blood. I smell blood. They accused the person of something that they didn't do. It was out of jealousy. And I am smelling blood. I'm right there on the accident scene where the thing took place. Ah, thank you, Holy Spirit. I pray today, oh God, have mercy. Show mercy. Oh God, don't let that person die. Give them strength so they can come back and testify. I smell blood. I smell blood. I smell blood. Fresh blood. Mighty God, hot blood. It happened during the daytime. But they won't find out because they'll try to hide the body because they think this person will die. So they're going to try to dispose the body. But I pray that the life won't leave the body. I pray that life will never leave this body. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I smell blood. I smell blood. I pray right now. I cover every soul that is here and their relatives and friends. I cover my children, my grandchildren. In the blood of Jesus Christ, I come up against premature death. I come up against sudden death. I pray that life will be preserved because of the salt covenant. Lives will be preserved. Anything that is a hindrance, I pray that it will be broken by the salt covenant. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You know, the Bible said, when God told Elijah to go to Elisha, Elisha wasn't saved. He was a businessman. He was a businessman minding his business. But something happened. Jezebel threatened Elijah. He wanted to die. So he told God to kill him. God said, no. Go and raise up Elisha so he can succeed you. So Elisha was not aware of this. What God was doing. You see, many times, the plan that God has for our life, we are not aware. The Bible said, God told Elijah, go and find Elisha. So Elisha was tending to the animals. He was like operating the plow according to the Bible. And Elijah passed by him with his jacket or his prayer shawl, because back in those days, your prayer shawl is like a piece of garment. It had sleeve. So he took the garment and he cast it on Elisha. That where the connection started. It was not with words. It was with an action. So, I guess back in those days when you take your clothes and touch somebody with it, it means a lot. We have to remember that the Bible said also there was a time when Naomi told Ruth to take her clothes and cover the feet of Boaz. So I guess I'm just saying, back in those days, the garment was very important. When you put your garment on someone, it meant a lot. You're draping them. It was a way of expressing love. It was a gesture, love gesture. Amen. The Bible said Elisha was connected to Elijah to start his ministry. God handpicked Elisha. He was not saved, he was just a businessman. But God handpicked him. And the moment Elisha started to walk with Elijah, he never looked back. Many times Elijah wanted to get rid of him. Many times Elijah wanted to get rid of Elisha to see how bad he wanted this ministry. And to that day, Elisha did not know that God told Elijah to train him up to be a prophet. Elijah had a school. Many times Elijah said, I want to go someplace. I can't take you with me. And I'll be back. Elisha said, No. I'm coming with you. You're not leaving me. Wherever you go, I'll go. Jesus. I came today to share this information. Never take connections for granted. When God connects you to some people, never take it for granted. Jesus. It came from God. Many times God put some people in our life and we don't know how to treat them. We don't know. Everyone come around us, they mistreat us. So when God send the right person, we don't know how to treat them. We end up hurting these people. Hallelujah. Sometimes God will send people to help you with your business, with your ministry. Sometimes it started with business. We are working out some kind of business, and then it turned out that this person is a destiny helper to help you to the next level in ministry. Don't take this person for granted. They didn't come on their own. God sent them. My God. We all need someone to be connected to. So today we pray that God will send us the right people so we can connect with them. Remember when Naomi went to Moab, she did not know Ruth. But Ruth ended up marrying one of her sons. Oprah married to her another son. Her sons died. Naomi lost her husband. She got broke. So she's going back home. Ruth went with her. Naomi was Ruth's destiny helper. Many times your destiny helper don't have money. Hello, somebody. They have connections. Many of you, you don't want to hang out with certain people because they don't have money. Your destiny helper can be broke. We all need to be connected to the right people to go to the next level. The right people, we want to be connected to them in Christ. There are some people that we will be connected to in ministry. It's not permanent. It's only for a time. But we need the connection. Ruth said to Naomi, wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you die, I will die. That was love. Remember, I just talk about Joshua, Elisha, and Elijah. I talk about David and Jonathan. It was love. When Elisha met with Elijah, it was love. Because God sent him. Now, Naomi is going back home. Ruth said, I'm coming. I'm sorry. Wherever they bury you, they're going to have to bury me. That was love. We need connections, good connections, people to be connected with, so we can live our fulfilled life that God has for us. Our assignment can be fulfilled. We need the right connections. Mighty God, there are three levels of people we need in our life. Oh Jesus, we need the ones that are above us so they can mentor us and correct us when we are wrong. We need those people in our life that we will mentor, the ones that are above us. They know more than we do. God has given them knowledge and wisdom. So we need those people. We need to connect with those people. People that are above us. Hallelujah. We need to connect with them. They have something to teach us. To speak in our life. To guide us. To correct us when we're wrong. And number two, we need the ones that are at our level. We need some people that are at our level. They will inspire us. Little things that we miss, they come with it, you know. And number three, we need the people that are beneath us. Why? Why do you need somebody who is beneath you? They will remind you of who you were. Remind you of your level. They will remind you that is the grace of God that brought you to where you are. They will push you. The people that are beneath you are the ones who push you. Did you know? People that are beneath you are the ones who push you because they see greatness in you. When you decide to give up, they are the one that said, you better do that because I want to be just like you. So when you get discouraged, these people push you. They motivate you. Did you know? Are you aware? They want to be like you. Don't take it for granted. Don't take these people for granted. Hallelujah. Remember, where you are right now is somebody's prayer request to be where you are. You might want to give up. You might say, I'm not doing well in life. I'm done. I'm giving up. But there are somebody today that want your position. That is on your prayer request. Did you know that you, wherever you are, at this psychological moment, somebody's prayer request is where you are? Right at your spot, at your current location, in your current situation. Let me use myself for example. Somebody is praying to God that they'll be able to have the courage to go on social media in their home and preach. That's their prayer request. It doesn't matter how long they're in ministry. Maybe they're not in ministry. Maybe they are living in sin and they just want to be seen. They think they have a story to tell that will encourage or inspire someone else. Your steps that you're taking today, it will determine your tomorrow. The things that you are doing today is Monday. The things that you are doing today, Monday, it will determine what will happen Tuesday. Never be too quick to say never to a friend. In some friendship, you will be afflicted. You will be wounded. And it's natural. And sometimes you are the one that will bring the affliction. You are the one that will wound. In some friendships, you will be afflicted. You will be wounded. And many of the times you are the one that it's caused by. So never say never. Because many times you will end up in the wrong. We are living in a world filled with sin, shame, and disgrace. Many times people don't like you because you cannot meet their needs. Lord Jesus, if you meet some people's needs, they will see you as a great person, phenomenal person. If you meet some people's needs, you are the best. If people can get to use you, you are the greatest. I never learned that until I moved to the United States of America. When they can get to use you, oh, you're so sweet, you're so nice, you're so kind. They love you. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad the boss is here. The Don is here. Look who is here. Anointed one from God is here. When you can meet their needs, when you can fulfill people's needs, you are the greatest thing on earth. And if you don't meet their expectation, you are evil. You are wicked. You are bad. When you don't meet some people's expectation, especially when God used me to bring some message and it convicts some pastors, they'll twist my arm if they could catch me. They would buck me down if they could catch me. Because I'm not preaching to make them feel good. I'm not Pastor Feel Good. That's not my name. God did not ordain me to make any individual feel good. I don't know how to make people feel good. If you want to feel good, go read your Bible. It's either the scripture is going to, the message is going to heal you, or it's going to convict you. Two reasons why people go to church. To be healed when they are wounded. Or to be convicted when they are not living right. So it's two reasons why people go. To take off the band-aid or to put on the band-aid. Jesus. If you don't meet some people's desire, that's why never say never. There are some friends, everything is going good once you can benefit them. But when you cannot benefit them anymore, you are the worst person. You are evil. But remember what they said about John. The Bible said, oh Jesus, somebody will hate me for this. The Bible said, when Jesus was eating and drinking among them, they call him glutton. He was greedy. But when John the Baptist came and he didn't eat from anybody, he didn't drink their dirty wine, he didn't eat their dirty food, they said John was evil. When John the Baptist didn't eat from them, they call him evil. When Jesus eat and drink with them, they said he was a wine bibber, he was glutton. You cannot please everybody. Who am I talking to here today? You will never be able to please everybody in this life. Could somebody go ahead and share this message? When you don't meet people's expectations, if you could be a fly on the wall in their kitchen or their living room to hear what they say about you. If you could be, Sister Jolene, if you could be a fly on the wall in some people's house to hear how they disgrace me. To hear how they slaughter me. Just a fly on the wall. This is why never say never. My name is not Pastor Feel Good. I do not know how to make anybody feel good. That's not my profession. Hallelujah. When I want to feel good, I dig into the Word of God. Listen to me, people. This is all about love. We cannot build a relationship on rocky grounds. Why? Because when problem comes, we won't have any foundation to stand on. We have to build relationship on truth. So when problem comes, we have firm foundation to stand on. And this is why the Bible said, let your yes be a yes. Let your no be a no. Sometimes no is very powerful. Let your yes be a yes. If you should, I'm not trying to go around in circles. If you should hear some things, some so-called relatives of mine say about me, you would spit on them. Yes. Because I did not meet their expectation. I'm not a man pleaser. The Bible said, don't be men pleasers. When you don't do things to meet relatives and friends and those people that we associate with. Hey. If words could kill, many of us would die. You see why I have to be praying in my house. Amen. We need to pray. In the book of Mark, there was a little thing between Jesus and Peter where Jesus had to rebuke him. I'm not going to go deep, but I'm going to say this. Some friendship will last until your status change. Everything was going well when you were a nobody. But once you become somebody, they begin to betray you. Many people, your status change, and that's the day you begin to lose family and friends. Everything was fine when you were living in sin. But when you come to Jesus Christ and you're serious, and they realize that you're radical, you're doing God's work, they don't like you. So you see, we cannot build ministry with hypocrites. God had to allow El Shaddai to leave some people alone in order to establish it. God had to allow some people to walk away from El Shaddai. It's true. If you are living in sin and they can come to your house and eat and drink and be merry, everything is fine. Turn your life over to Jesus and begin to walk in the truth. You will eventually have to get rid of them because they no longer mean anything to you. Why? Because you're moving on. So your status change. They cut you off. They speak against you. They talk bad about. They badmouth you. All you receive is backlash. But today I pray against every backlash that will come to El Shaddai because of its establishment. Today we set fire to every backlash that will come up against us in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Today I pray that backlash will come, but we will be strong to bind and destroy them in the name of Jesus. And for those of you that are coming with your covenant seed and you're thinking that it will bring backlash, today we chop off every hand that will be raised up against your seed. In the name of Jesus, every hand that will raise up against your covenant seed, we chop it off. Every hand. Yes, they will sidestep you. They will talk bad about you. They will even start postings on social media about you to make themselves look good. Let me share something with you. Some people will never speak the truth. But if you open your mouth, it's a whole different ballgame. We are establishing a church. We're not establishing it on hypocrisy. I refuse to move a foot until God speak.
And this is why God is surprising some people this year in this ministry. God is surprising you. God wants you to be surprised. And you're going to say, oh, Pastor, I never say this. No, God wants to surprise you, to let you know he is in control. He is the one that is ordaining our steps. Mighty God. The Bible tells us that Miriam and Aaron was bitter against Moses. God was using Moses. And God made a mistake and brought Miriam and Aaron to help. In ministry now, when Moses was a baby, Miriam was the one that the mama sent to put the baby in the lake, in the river Nile, to go down so he could end up in Pharaoh's home. Amen. But when God, Moses become a man and God begin to use him, some people think you're too small to be used by God because they're older, they're bigger, they know more than you. God choose who he please. He is no respecter of person. There are some people in our family, they're very close to us, and they don't think that we deserve the position that God gave us. There are some people that we are friends with. We are very close to them, and they don't think that we deserve the position we have in ministry. May the Lord have mercy upon them. May the Lord have mercy upon them. There are some people that didn't like our appearance, so they don't care for what came out of our appearance, which is us. We are the offspring of our appearance. And people that never like our appearance will never like us. People that never like, even if they didn't know, when they found out who we are, they cut us off because they did not like. And let me tell you, this is so true. If your sisters and your brothers don't like you, they will never love your children. Why? Because they didn't like you. They'll pretend to hurt you. They'll pretend just to get close to your children to hurt them if they can. But today, we set fire to every evil relative that is among us. If they didn't like your parents, they're not going to like you. Remember that. If they did not like your mother, they won't like you. Even if they didn't know that it's you when they found out, I'm here to let you know, they will give you a hard time. Somebody said this is a confirmation. It's true. I know. I have seen it. The people that never like my father, they don't like me. The people that never like my mother, they don't like me. Why? I'm not a version of my mother. I'm not a version of my father. I am different. I'm not here to be liked. If they didn't like you, write this down. They will not like your children. Some of them will try to get close to your children. Watch them, because they are going to hurt your child. I'm telling you this right here. If your siblings don't care for you, don't trust them with your children. If your brothers and your sisters don't care for you, do not trust them with your children. I'm not holding my breath. I'm not talking with my mouth on the ground. I'm telling you, whoever didn't like me will not like my children. Don't pretend that you like my children when you know you didn't like me. Stop it. It makes you a hypocrite. How can you love my children and you don't speak to me? Look at you. I set fire to you and your plans. They didn't like your parents. What make you think you're different? They're only getting close to you to destroy you. I'm telling you, when family members, listen to me, this is nothing to play with. This is not, remember what David said to Samuel, Solomon. He said, that Joab, he gave me hard time. Please kill him. I'm talking Bible. David told Solomon when Solomon became king. He said, Joab didn't like me. Joab disgraced me. Joab killed a lot of people innocently and caused me to shame. I'm asking you to slay him. How was he slain?
Solomon didn't kill him himself. He was slain in the church. He went into the church and held on to the pulpit and wouldn't let it go. He held on to one of the posts that helped. And I'm here to let you know, Solomon sent somebody to drop down on him. If he didn't like your daddy, he didn't like your mother, what makes you think he's going to like you? He's trying to get close to you to hurt you. I have lived it. I have seen it when I came to America. The people that didn't like my father, I went among them and they tread me. They sieved me like wheat. I'm not babbling. I'm not holding my breath. The people that are related to my father, they sieved me like wheat. Hey, and these are the people that will talk, oh, you act like you're better than them, and you say you're a child of God. Fire! Go clean up yourself. They sift me in Florida. They sift me like wheat. I had to run away from among them. My God. Tomorrow, I will give you the conclusion of today's message to let you know there are some people, stay away from them. It doesn't matter how many tongues you're speaking, leave them alone. The Lord will protect you. But don't take poison and depend on busy. Use wisdom. There are some people, you have to leave them alone. They are not your friends. You might be related to them, but as the word of God came earlier, if there is something wrong around you, be that instrument of change. You cannot fix them, so exit. Exit. Remember, David had to go up against his own son. Why? Because the devil began to use his sons. One even pretend to be king. So I'm here to let you know. Remember, David said to Solomon, that Joab, don't spear him. Don't spear him. He gave me a hard time, but I couldn't kill him. David couldn't kill him. He killed too many men, so he couldn't kill him. Hey, may the Lord give us strength to deal with those who we have to deal with. May the Lord give us strength to deal with. You see, when you're entering into ministry, you cannot be soft. You cannot be soft. When you're entering into ministry, if you're soft, people are going to walk over you. I had a vision many years ago before my mother died. The Lord told me to cook and feed people and give things out to them. So my mother was helping with the food because she was a good cook. My mother was helping with the food and I was there giving them the drinks and praying for them. And I had the dream more than once. So I called my mother and I told her. She said, oh, me? I'm not doing that. I'm already in ministry. People really don't like me. I'm not doing that. You can do it if you want to. Not long after that, my mother died. She didn't take the assignment. She was already in ministry, facing backlash and hardship and all kind of stuff. So I'm here to let you know. I went to Rome 2 weeks ago in Italy. And when I was in the Vatican City, in the church, when I went into the church,
what they call it, St. Peter's Basilica, where Peter's body was buried. While I was leaving that building, one of the Roman guard, he had a sword on his hip. On his hip. He's a guard. I didn't see a gun. I see a sword, long sword. Let me see if I can find a picture of what he I think I took a picture of him. Amen. I did. I took a picture of the guard. Hallelujah. And when I walk outside, this is what he looks like. He have a spear in his hand. You see, the spear is taller than him. And a sword on the other side. This is the picture I took of the man. It's spiritual. We don't wrestle with flesh and blood. We wrestle with principalities and powers. This is how we dress. Like a clown. You know, back today we call them, this is the costume of a clown. This is what he looks like outside of the church, right at the door, right at the door of the church. But when he was on the inside, I was on his other side, so I saw, see, he's standing by the gate, right there by the gate. This is the gate. This right here is the gate. This part here is the gate. Roman guard. Who work inside the St. Peter's Basilica. That's what they call the church, the Basilica. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I want you to know, you have to be radical. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Jesus. And the word basilica is what they use to describe those big churches. And the word basilica, it means a large oblong hall or building with double colonnades and a semicircular apse, used in ancient Rome as a court of law for public assemblies. A building similar to a Roman basilica used as a Christian church. The name given to certain churches granted special privilege by the Pope. So only the Pope can approve a building to be called a basilica. Because it's law. It's called the Vatican City. The Vatican City, the word Vatican City meaning that the law of the Pope. And these are the people that govern the words of the Bible. All the scriptures have to go through Rome to be approved. Even if you write in your own Bible. You know they have different versions of the Bible. Rome have to approve that. And this is why there's a lot of war going on with the Seventh-day Adventists and the Jehovah Witnesses with them. They cut them off. Rome cut off Seventh-day Adventists and Jehovah Witnesses. There's a lot of church politics going on. So you see why they call it the Basilica. And where in the world they talk about Basilica like that? It has to be approved by the Pope. Did anybody hear this? Did anybody hear this? It has to be approved. So you see how important
Rome is one of the most important places. Israel is where Jesus is from. Amen. But Rome is the important place concerning the word of God. Israel, the grounds where Jesus walked and all of that, has nothing to do with Rome. Rome is the business place of the Bible, of the word of God. The Vatican City, where everything is documented. Is anybody listening? It's politics. It's all about politics. And this is why we should not run competition with anyone, because when you get to go to Rome, you get to realize, like, you have a wake-up call. That is where the organization that started this. The organization of the Bible has to be approved by the Vatican City. A building has to... It's time for us to know God for ourselves. When you go to those places, it's law. Everything is law. I remember we went into a room they call the Sistine Chapel. And in that chapel, they got officers ready to arrest you if you speak loud. You can't talk in there. You have to be quiet in the Sistine Chapel. It's a chapel. No service is happening. And it's not a big room. And all that's in that room are pictures on the wall that was done by Michelangelo about Jesus' life, about sinners, about all kind of things that happened in the past. And you can't talk loud in that building, that room. People are dressed with headphones, what you call it, ready to arrest you. This is a holy place. You got to be quiet. You can't speak. We reverence God wherever we go. But I'm letting you know, this is personal. That was the only place that we went to where they told us that we have to be quiet. And I did not feel the presence of God in there. I did not feel the presence of God in that room. And they told us to be quiet. It is a holy room. It's true. They were ready to arrest you for talk. You can't speak in that room. Your voice cannot be heard. You can hear people breathing when you're in that room. In Rome, in the Sistine Chapel, in the Vatican City. You can hear other people breathing. I pray that God take over. I didn't feel the presence of the Holy Spirit, because he's with me all the time. But I didn't feel his presence in that room. It is my biggest desire that each and every one of you on this platform who has never been to Rome to tour and have people to explain things to you to do it. It is my desire that you have the opportunity to do it. To go to Rome, go to the Vatican City, have a tour guide, pay for it, and get it done. It's holy for them, but it's not holy. The Holy Spirit was not with me in that room. There was no one to explain anything to you in that room. In that room, you have to take out your headphones and give it back to the people that gave it to you. They say you won't need it. You could hear people breathing in the room. And it's a room filled with pictures on the wall, in the ceiling. Nothing else. No chairs. You can't sit down. If you want to catch, and me with my tired self, I had to lean on the wall and catch. And you know, I feel so bad. I'm trying again to apologize to the people who had to tolerate me, to put up with me, because I could hardly make it. The spirit was there with me, but my body, my knees couldn't manage those tears. My inability to go fast was evident. So I pray that each and every one of you here who has never been to Rome, plan a trip. I will plan a trip, but I want to go to Israel first. Things have to make sense. Things have to make sense. Believe me. You cannot enter a church and don't feel the presence of God. That don't make no sense. It doesn't matter who was there before you. It doesn't matter if it's a building where idol worshippers dwell. Tell me that's what it is. Don't fool me. Don't fool me. I was so angry when I was there in Rome. I was angry. And one of the things I said after the tour when I walk out, if I don't eat another meal since till I get back to America, I don't mind. My curiosity is filled. I was satisfied. I have seen, my eyes have seen what the Lord wanted me to see. God had to take me through many years of studying the Word of God before I get to Rome. But my eyes have seen what God wanted me to see. Amen. Let us pray. Let us pray for El Shaddai Prayer Tower. Let us pray for the... I didn't feel God in that building. And I saw men with sword on their hip. And it's a church, right? Let us pray for the establishment of El Shaddai Prayer Tower. Let us pray for the covenant seed. Open them out and let us pray. Father, we thank you. We bless you today for what you have done, for what you have given us, for what you have allowed our eyes to see. Father, I thank you that your people was able to see through my eyes when I went to Italy. Lord, let it be well with them. Let their spirit be settled. Lord, we ask you for the establishment of El Shaddai Prayer Tower. Let it be well with the people that will come. Send faithful servants. Send helpers. Send destiny helpers. Send kingdom builders to build. Lord, we ask you, send kingdom financiers to finance the ministry so we can have what we need to go further with the work of your work in the name of Jesus Christ. And Lord, as for these people who have partnered with the ministry, with their covenant seed, we ask you in the name of Jesus to establish them. Answer the prayer requests. Let it be well with them in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We pray with thanksgiving. Amen. My God. It's not easy. If you are on the fasting with us, today is day number 5 of our fasting. I invite you to pick up your water, your crackers, your fellowship cup, whatever it is you have. Amen. And the Bible tells us in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11. My God. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 24. It says, the night before Jesus was betrayed, he broke bread with his disciples. Hallelujah. He did. The night before Jesus was betrayed, he broke bread with his disciples. He knew that he was going to be betrayed. And yet he broke bread with his disciples. Jesus. It is well. He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Father, we pray that this communion will bring healing to many.
We pray for the covenant partners that are fasting with us. We pray for those who are on the fasting. We pray for El Shaddai. We pray, Lord God, that as they break this communion today, as they break bread today, there will be good news coming from the east, the west, the north, and south. According to your word, declare a thing and it shall be established. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen. The Bible tells us that the night before he was betrayed, he broke bread. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Break it." He said, "As often as you do it in remembrance of me." Go ahead and eat it. Then, verse 25 said, Jesus picked up the cup and he raised it up and he said, "This is the New Testament in my blood. As often as you do it in remembrance of me." Go ahead and drink. So sweet. My God, people of God, listen. There is so much for us to know. So much for us to see. So many places for us to go. I pray that God open your doors. So whenever we have to meet, you will be able to afford it. If you want to sow in this fasting, because there is a situation that needs correction, that needs to be addressed, the number is 860-634-8557. If you are not a member of any ministry and you want to join us, you can send us a message on WhatsApp. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of me. Don't be afraid. Some people don't take calls because they don't want to talk to Rev. Don't be afraid. Send us a message on WhatsApp and we will respond within 24 hours. I'm here to let you know God is with you. You just have to be obedient. God is love. And he is sending people to show you love so you can feel love and be appreciated. Yes, you have been burned many times, but God is sending the right people in this season, not to betray you, not to deceive you, but to show you love. My God. I don't know who God is using me to tell that one. But I want you to know, if you are a member of a different church and you want to partner with us in giving, we do charity every month. Whatever the Lord touch your heart to give, you can send it to Zelle, PayPal, or Cash App. And for those of you who are covenant partners, remember, you have to write down your prayer request and pray over it. Write down your prayer request and pray over it. I know a few people called last week. I was not available because it was a rough week. Last weekend was very rough for me. So forgive me if I didn't make it to your phone call or I didn't make it back to you yet. If you are interested in joining us in the covenant for the next 6 months, it's $50 every month. So I encourage you to send your seed so we can hold it up before God. Send off your covenant seed. Partner with us if you are in a different ministry. We are asking God for establishment of your prayer request and establishment of El Shaddai prayer tower. May the Lord continue to bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance. I love you with the love of the Lord, and he give you his peace. Amen. My mother used to say, "You see those eyes?" So thank God I'm wearing glasses. Oh Lord, my mother used to say, "You see those eyes? You're going to get people into trouble because you have those eyes." Amen.
It is my prayer that you were blessed today by this by today's message. I thank God for this ministry and the things that he is doing, and I thank God that I'm a part of it. I will never take it for granted. I never ever think for a second in my life that I am better than anyone. I am not. If the Lord take away the strength from me today, I'll be nothing. So I'm nothing without him. So I have to express my love daily for the Lord and my labor of love. And this is why I'm faithful to God. I know what it's like to have nothing. I know what it's like to go to bed without dinner. I know what it's like to be homeless. And I could continue, but it's not about me. It's all about Jesus. I never think for a day. Never take this position that the Lord give me for granted. Mm-mm. I won't. I refuse to. I'm not better than anyone, so I have to speak the truth. As God as my witness, I cannot lie. He will beat me with many stripes, and I don't want any beatings. So if the word of God offend you, take it up to the Lord in prayer. Some people used to say, oh, you're talking about me because you know my business. You talk, stop it. If the message brings conviction, repent. We thank God. God bless you all. I thank, you see, I'm taking my portion from this message as well. I have to take my portion. So I give honor and praise to God, who is head of this ministry. People of God, let's continue to pray for the establishment of El Shaddai Prayer Tower. It takes finances to run ministry. We cannot do it without your help. You will benefit from it. So I invite you to be a blessing to the ministry so we can continue to do God's work. My time is up. I have to go. God bless you all.